So number 27, the momentum of, or the effective mass and momentum of an X-ray. So if you have nanometers, 0.35 nanometers, that gives you the wavelength. And so, remember, mass times velocity is momentum. So if we solve for momentum is equal to Planck's constant divided by wavelength, we can actually get the momentum of an X-ray. Then, if we remember that mass times velocity is embedded in that momentum, we can isolate mass. So it turns out the mass, the effective mass of an electromagnetic wave is equal to the momentum divided by the speed of light. Good stuff. So 32, we can actually use our Compton shift equation that we discussed earlier. Again, remember, we have an incident photon that collides with an electron. I like this visual because it shows it changing to the red spectrum, an electron being kicked off. And you got theta for the photon and phi for the electron. So the shift in wavelength, all you have to do is put in your different thetas, 1 minus theta. So what's the first one on 32? 45 degrees, then 90, and 180 degrees. So here's a fun one using the mass-like objects having a wavelength. So we have a mass of a bowling ball, again, a given velocity. And we can, in essence, instead of calculating the apparent mass, we can calculate the apparent wavelength. So all we need to do is put in the mass times velocity, go with Planck's constant divided by that product, and you'll get it. You'll notice it's extremely small, so it's not really realistic, but it's fun to think about. 37 is asking for the wavelength of a neutrino, and the neutrino is a very, really, really tiny particle. It's a great history in itself of how they discovered the neutrino. So this is more appropriate use of the equation. So mass is very, very small. They calculate, they can find the velocity, and so we can find the apparent wavelength of a mass-like object. Good stuff.